Belinda, and Harper Audio Australia present this unabridged recording of The Smack Track, Inside the Navy's War, Chasing Down Drug Smugglers, Pirates and Terrorists. Written by Ian McPhedran and read by Peter Byrne. The dedication reads, to the men and women of the Royal Australian Navy and their families. Preface. Landing in a helicopter on the rolling and pitching deck of a warship at sea for the first time can be a white-knuckle experience, even for veteran flyers. Sitting in a rigid hull inflatable boat alongside a Navy boarding party as it bounces across the open ocean is a different type of wild ride, but when these two things happen on consecutive days, they have a major impact. So it was in 2007 when I joined the Anzac-class frigate HMAS Toowoomba on patrol in the Arabian Gulf for a brief visit and a taste of an Australian Navy deployment in the Middle East. As the RHIB sped across the oily waters of the Gulf, a dot appeared on the horizon. Soon, that dot grew into a 300,000-ton supertanker, and before I knew it, I was following the agile young sailors several stories high, up the ship's ladder and onto her vast deck. The boarding team, under the command of an officer who looked 20 years old, went about the business of searching the vessel and quizzing the Indian captain and his crew with a professionalism that belied their years. The Navy's three-decade-long Middle East story has been largely overlooked because of the higher profile and more immediate media access offered by the Army and Air Force. But after a second visit aboard warships in the Gulf, I knew that this terrific Australian story needed to be told. Almost a decade later, I was fortunate to join the guided missile frigate HMAS Darwin in Dar es Salaam Harbour in May 2016, as she embarked on a two-week Indian Ocean patrol between Tanzania and the Seychelles. It was the ship's seventh and final Middle East deployment, and her prime targets were drugs and weapon smugglers on what Australian sailors have dubbed the Smack Track. The so-called war against terrorism has gone through many phases since it began on the 11th of September 2001, but one aspect has remained constant, and that is the presence in and around the Gulf region of warships from the Royal Australian Navy, which has had vessels patrolling the waters of the Middle East, South Asia, and East Africa almost constantly since 1990. Over 64 rotations of 20 major fleet units, many thousands of Australian officers and sailors have forged their own stories in the calm seas of the Arabian Gulf, or the wilder waters off the Horn of Africa and deep in the Western Indian Ocean. This book tells part of their story. Ian McPhedran, Sydney, 2017. Prologue. The young male and female sailors scramble down a rope ladder and into the bucking, rigid hull inflatable boat that's tethered to the side of the Australian warship. With the frigate steaming at 14 knots in the open ocean, this is not a job for the faint-hearted. In a dangerous sea state 4, with a buffeting wind and 3-metre waves, the armed and fully kitted-out members of HMAS Darwin's red boarding team are dropping into a maelstrom. It is 11:25 a.m. on Saturday, the 21st of May, 2016, and we're in the Indian Ocean, several hundred kilometres to the east of Tanzania and north of Madagascar, hunting drug smugglers on the Smack Track. For one young woman, the conditions are just too severe, and she's quickly replaced. Upper body strength is vital under these extremes. Once the first group of boarders have made it safely into the RHIB, it is set free and speeds away towards a suspect fishing dhow that is wallowing about a kilometre away under the watchful eye of the guided missile frigate. Viewing the operation from the safety of Darwin's deck, it is clear that my wish to board a smuggling dhow is unlikely to be granted unless the sea calms down an awful lot. Sea State 4 is at the upper limit for a water-based boarding by the Royal Australian Navy. As the RHIB approaches, the suspect dhow rolls through an alarming-looking 40 degrees, and boarding officer Lieutenant James Hodgkinson deems it too risky to continue. Climbing down into the RHIB from a moving 4,000-ton warship is one thing for these skilled and athletic sailors, but scrambling up a rope and onto a 20-meter wooden dhow that is bucking around like an angry rodeo bull could be deadly. In addition, the team's radios have become waterlogged and communication with the ship is lost. Just before noon, they turn and speed back towards Darwin, but suddenly their radio crackles back to life and the skipper, Commander Phil Henry, orders the team to have another go. The inflatable boat turns back to the dhow. This time, its captain is instructed via hand signals to turn his vessel down sea to make conditions a little easier for boarding. Transferring sailors to the dhow is all about timing. In such a high sea state, the two vessels are almost level at the top of each swell. The boarders can therefore avoid using the rope ladder, but must risk leaping directly from the RHIB onto the dhow. Once safely on board, their first job is to herd the crew forward into the forecastle area and to secure the vessel while the RHIB returns to Darwin to collect the rest of the boarding party, along with the American NCIS agent, Paul Lerzer, and his interpreter to interview the captain and crew. Time is of the essence. It's soon clear that the skipper's story about why such a small coastal fishing boat is operating so far south of its home, on the Makran coast between Pakistan and Iran, and so far from land, is ridiculous. The vessel is not flying a valid flag. Her fishing nets have not even been deployed, and the paperwork contains some major inconsistencies. The authorities at headquarters in Bahrain authorize a search, and the arduous task of checking every square centimeter of the vessel begins. Just before 5 p.m., a member of the dhow's crew secretly lets on that there are drugs on board, stashed beneath the snow in the ice hold. Rather than go directly to the spot, give the game away and potentially endanger the informant's life, the team continues to chip away at the edge of the ice before moving to the centre of the hold, where they eventually find a suspect hatch hidden below the frozen sheet. Able seaman Eddie Tomsana, from Thursday Island in the Torres Strait, is used to living rough on small boats, but even he is shocked by the conditions on board the dhow, as he and his shipmate Pete Irvine get down and dirty, urgently searching the rancid fish hold, their only company are rats nesting deep in the boat's bilge. Even the cockroaches swarming in the galley area up top don't venture down into this dark, filthy, frozen world. The men use a crowbar to remove the hatch cover, and bingo, there's a stash of white bags underneath. Tomsana gets down on his belly and crawls into the stinking, rat-infested hiding place. At first he pulls out 5, then another 7, and finally dozens of bags, containing an incredible 512 kilograms of heroin, a cache with an estimated street value of more than $500 million that will no longer fund terrorist organizations and criminal syndicates. The mission. 1. Leaving Dar es Salaam. The timber fishing dhows, beached outside the bustling fish market, frame a huge crowd of Africans undertaking their daily ritual of haggling over the catch. This colourful scene at the entrance to Dar es Salaam harbour plays out under the watchful eyes of Royal Australian Navy sailors, who are manning 50 calibre machine guns mounted high above the bridge of the guided missile frigate HMAS Darwin. The warship's 228-strong company is embarking on a 2-week patrol of the southern Indian Ocean in pursuit of a much more insidious catch, heroin and hashish, grown and processed deep in the valleys of Afghanistan, and weapons bound for terrorist groups plying their evil trade somewhere on the troubled African continent. Darwin will be operating between Tanzania and the holiday paradise of the Seychelles Islands, a smuggling hotspot. A mere mention of the names Tanzania and the nearby island of Zanzibar conjures up images of darkest Africa and the slave trade. Dar es Salaam, the capital of Tanzania, is a port city that sits about halfway down the east coast of the African continent. It has been a key Indian Ocean trading hub for centuries, and not just for the exotic spices carried on the ancient maritime routes by the favourable trade winds. During the 1800s, Zanzibar was the centre of the world's slave trade, and more than 50,000 people were sold each year in its notorious market to buyers from America and the Middle East. Large-scale human trafficking has long since given way to other destructive and highly lucrative trades in human misery. The waters off the East African coast are awash with fishing and cargo dhows attempting to land smuggled drugs, mainly hashish and heroin, or weapons. From this strategic staging post, the guns abound for trouble spots such as Somalia, Yemen, and Sudan. The drugs will travel further afield, by air, using passengers as mules, by charter flights, or overland in trucks or cars, driving south through Mozambique and South Africa, or northeast through Kenya, and onwards to the wealthy criminal markets in Europe and beyond. In the post-9/11 era, the narcotics trade is one of the primary sources of funding for terrorist organizations. The illicit drugs come from the Golden Crescent, an opium-growing belt that stretches from Iran through Afghanistan and into northern Pakistan. Most of the opium is grown in Afghanistan, and heroin from the Crescent supplies markets in Europe and the United States. The Golden Triangle of Myanmar, Burma, Laos, and Thailand feeds markets in Australia, the US, and Asia. Although engines have long since replaced sails, little has changed over the centuries for the men who work on board the fleet of timbered dhows that are beached outside the busy fish market. Whatever meagre amount the smugglers get paid by drug barons to transport their lethal cargoes will far outstrip their poor income from fishing. It is 8 a.m., and the crew of HMAS Darwin is on defence watch and at high alert. The fighting ship moves away from her berth just forward of the German frigate FGS Byrne, and slips slowly down the narrow harbour towards the Indian Ocean. Each gunner is in radio contact with the PWO, the Principal Warfare Officer, who relays warnings and commands from his armour-plated bunker. The PWO, Lieutenant Brett Schultz and his staff, monitor a suite of powerful electronic sensors inside the ship's locked and darkened operations room. These high-tech tools of trade include radars, cameras, and infrared equipment that scan the surroundings constantly. The most sensitive pieces of equipment are well hidden in a corner behind a heavy black curtain at the rear of the ops room that's out of bounds to anyone without a security clearance. Having joined the vessel 2 hours earlier, this landlubber author is greeted by the commanding officer, CO Commander Phil Henry, who says, "Welcome aboard." The WWO, or Weapons Electrical Engineering Officer, Lieutenant Commander Jason O'Gorman, will be your escort for the first day or so, and then you'll have the run of the ship. This is music to the ears of someone who's used to the strict media controls often imposed during Australian military embeds in covering the prolonged conflicts of the Middle East. Crossing from the dock onto the ship is like venturing into another dimension, where time and space become more finite and the norms of a life on land are left behind as the routine of the mariner takes over. Once the gangway is secured and the mooring line stowed, the warship becomes a fully self-contained space. This new world is a mere 138 metres long and 13.8 metres wide. The trials and tribulations of this planet are distilled into this steel box and the lives of the 228 people who inhabit it. As the warship glides past dozens of beached vessels and other boats crisscrossing the entrance to the harbour, every craft that passes by near the ship is regarded as a potential threat. No one wants a repeat of the USS Cole incident that took place in October 2000, when an explosives-laden terrorist skiff left 17 sailors dead and the American destroyer badly damaged in the port of Aden in Yemen. Nothing escapes the attention of the watchful security detail as I move close to them, high up on the ship's gun direction platform. Even a local lad who floats by in what looks like an upturned car bonnet, powered by nothing but a clear sheet of plastic mounted on a stick, comes under close scrutiny. Dar es Salaam is a rapidly changing city.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.